Thank you for being here tonight. We are the Fulton University Chorus. We're going to sing a few songs for you this evening in anticipation of the keynote speaker at 6 p.m. Hope everybody will be able to stick around and listen to Melvin Otey's lesson that he's prepared at that time. We're going to sing, 25 minutes maybe from this point on. We want to leave sufficient time to get the stage back the way it needs to be for the speaker at 6 p.m. The first song that we sang, God Himself is With Us, is a German hymn in origin. The piece we just sang, I Sat Down Under His Shadow, the text is taken from Song of Solomon, and the composer is Edward Bairstow. We're going to now sing a medley. It was made popular by the group GLAAD, and it includes excerpts from Beneath the Cross of Jesus and Hallelujah, What a Savior, and We Will Glorify the King of Kings, and it features lots of soloists. Let's see, Blake Clifton is going to sing a solo, and Hunter Smith is going to sing a solo, and Hunter Haney is going to sing a solo, and then other kind of quasi-solo moments would be Micah Green and Christian Smith and Natalie Willis and Rachel Evgen, and toward the end, they get mad at me when I mention their name, Gabby McNeely and Catherine Albritton, and then Barrett Hutto, I skipped Barrett, and Carly. There's lots of kind of little solo-y type moments there, so if I forgot somebody, I apologize. We'll sing that for you at this time. Before we do that, we're going to sing Christus Factus Est by Anton Bruckner. This is one of the five festival pieces we did in Abilene earlier this year, and it's really chromatic, if you're familiar with that term, if you've studied music at all. It goes through a plethora of key changes. So it's challenging, but it's rewarding at the same time. And you have translations, by the way, of all the foreign language pieces there in your printed program. So this is Christus Factus Est by Bruckner.
Thank you.
have a smaller group sing one or two pieces for you now. These are the Faulkner Singers, and they're going to get to sing, first of all, The Bluebird by Charles William Stanford. It's about a bluebird. And I jokingly kind of said a few times it's just kind of not necessarily sacred in the traditional sense, but one of the students pointed out to me that when they say the words at one point in The Bluebird, it caught his image, that his is capitalized. So there is a little element of, you know, the idea that God is seen in every single part of his creation, even in the smallest little bluebird. And then we'll follow that one by Ubi Caritas by Durafle. And again, there's a translation for those Latin words there in your program. So The Bluebird by Stanford and Ubi Caritas by Durafle. Now we've got a traditional spiritual by Hall Johnson, Ain't Got Time to Die. Morgan Baker is the soloist on this. Just four will do a smaller part in the middle. So it kind of gives some dynamic contrast between the sizes of the groups. Use some kind of internal smaller groups. Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God.
Thank you.
This next piece is from Mendelssohn's Elijah. It features just a whim, split three ways. It's called Lift Thine Eyes. And then we will also sing Set Me as a Seal. That's by Renee Claus, and the text comes from Song of Solomon, like one that we sang earlier did as well. And then we'll finish this set of three with Alleluia by Randall Thompson. Excited because the following morning my wife and I were getting up and going to the hospital, and she was going to give birth to our baby son, which means that today is his third birthday, and he's right over there. Charner, wave at everybody. Wave. And I was hoping that maybe you guys would indulge a proud father and sing happy birthday to him since we're all here together. If you would, please. Here we go.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
We are going to sing one more song for you. It's Hallelujah by Randall Thompson. Thank you for your kind attention tonight, and bear with us after this. We have to break down the stage, so we'll be making a little bit of noise to get everything ready for the speaker at 6 p.m.
Good evening. Good to have you tonight at our opening session of the Faulkner Lectureship and our evening worship here at the University Church of Christ. We appreciate the congregation here allowing us to use their facilities, and we get to do that often since they're so close by. We have so many people who are present tonight from our sister congregations, particularly that the lectureship has brought many people here, but also we've had the area-wide youth group meeting that's come and descended here and at the University Church of Christ. And so we're thankful to have so many good folks to support us and be involved in this opening session. I'm very excited. Of course, lectureship, the planning for it begins right after it's over, as we debrief and talk about things and we start planning for the next year. And so this is really a climactic event for us, and we're so excited that everyone is here and that we'll have your participation. I'm excited about the program tonight, about our speaker, but I'm going to turn it over to our director of the lectureship, David Hester.
Let me echo what Dean Glees has said about welcoming you to the lectureship this week, tonight, especially the kickoff service for the lectureship, and we're really looking forward to the events of the week. Our order of worship will be as follows. John Podine will lead us in our singing, and then the opening prayer will be led by Tim Mahler from Tallahassee, Florida, who is also one of our speakers this week. And then after President Williams gives the introduction for our speaker, Melvin Otey will be speaking to us this evening. John Podine will lead the invitation song, and then I will make some closing announcements and updates. And then the closing song will be led by Brother Podine, and then our closing prayer will be led by Brother Fincher Northern. So let's all prepare to worship as John comes to lead us in song.
Well, this is geared toward our youth tonight, and so a lot of the songs that you will see up here will be geared toward them. But as we begin, let's stand and let's sing together, if you would. I'm in the way, the bright and shining way.
I'm in the glory land way.
Following our singing of Blessed Assurance. Can he still feel the nails every time I fail? Can he give proud Christ crucified again? Am I causing him pain when I know I've got to change? Cause I just can't bear the thought of hurting him. Can he still feel the nails?
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, your beautiful bride of your Son, Jesus Christ, praises you at this time. We stand in amazement of your glory and your power, and we give thanks on this occasion for the opening of the 2017 Faulknership University Lectureship. As the body of Christ, we recognize the value of a spirit-based education, of instilling moral convictions, and the demand for personal responsibility of all of your children. All this designed to draw us nearer to you as you draw nearer to us in this time of worship and praise and holding you in the highest reverence. As the chorus sang just a little bit earlier, where there is charity and love, you are there. And it is the love of your Son that brings us together tonight and throughout the next 4 days. And over these days to come, dear Lord, let us seek a deeper understanding of your Spirit and to use this knowledge in order for us to be a brighter light and a more seasoned salt in this world. Be with the speaker of the hour and bless Brother Otey as he brings forth the message to us tonight. Open our minds to your word. Open our eyes to your truth. And always, dear Lord, open our hearts to the lost. Bless us as we kick off this wonderful time and this beautiful meeting. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
We're going to sing one more song before Dr. Williams comes up and introduces Melvin. Let's all stand and let's sing this song together, if you would.
There is beyond the azure blue a God concealed from human sight.
Thank you, John, for that great singing. I'm out of breath. Are you out of breath? I didn't realize singing was aerobic, but welcome. It is my honor to welcome you to Faulkner University and the 73rd Bible Lectures. I'm especially appreciative to David and Scott for really assembling a world-class program for us this week as we delve into the work of the Spirit. And I think that's an extremely appropriate one, at least for Faulkner University. Because we believe that being a Christ-centered university means more than just having chapel. We believe it means more than having required Bible classes. We believe it means more than just having a lofty code of conduct. We believe the essence of a Christ-centered university is every single graduate coming to grips with that God is calling them to lead a Spirit-led life and to join him in his redemptive work here in the world. And this year at Faulkner, we have a new laboratory. The laboratory is Davis Elementary, one of the most impoverished, lowest performing schools in our city. And we formed a partnership with them to just be the hands and feet of Jesus, to go into that community, not just our College of Ed, but just across the board, all students, to try to reflect what Jesus wants us to do, to reach in and be a part of restoring what he wanted from the beginning. I must tell you that about Christmas time, I met with the principal and one of our key liaisons, and I said, I don't think things are moving fast enough. There's more things that Faulkner can contribute to this community. And they said, Mike, do you realize that every single day there's either a student from Faulkner or a staff member or a faculty member in this school every single day? I said, no, I'm just the president. I don't know. And then Camille told me, with tears in her eyes, she said, just this morning I walked into the school. And as I was walking into the school, just ahead of me was Marquise, one of your undergraduates. And he was about 10 steps ahead of me. And when he walked through the door, I saw a 10-year-old drop his book bag and run as fast to him as possible and leap into his arms and hug him. She said, I know that 10-year-old boy. And Marquise is the most positive influence in his life. Just a couple weeks ago, we had one of our last home basketball games, and all the faculty came to one of the home basketball games because now Faulkner is their school. And during halftime, Camille told me, she said, well, we got a visit from the state this week. As some of you know, the Montgomery Public Schools have been taken over by the state part of education. Well, we got our visit this week. And the reason for the visit this week to Davis Elementary is because there's only one school in Montgomery, Alabama that made educational gains. It's Davis Elementary. It may be a fluke. It may be a coincidence. It may be statistically irrelevant. But none of the teachers at Davis believe that. You see, the same teachers are at Davis that were there last year. But as the principal told me, she said, this year our faculty think differently about their work because somebody believes in them. Somebody thinks that they can do it. Love is a powerful motivator. And what I see happening is over the next 5 years, I see lots of gains in that community being made. And Davis Elementary will be a stronger school because of it. But so will Faulkner University. We will be a better school because we're trying to live out the teachings of Jesus Christ and be a part of his redemptive force in the world. Part of maintaining our Christ-centeredness, I believe, is attracting world-class faculty and staff members, people who believe in the mission of God. And tonight, we're privileged that we can kick off this Bible lectures with one of our own. In fact, I just met a person who was driving through town just a couple hours ago, and I told him we were having a lectureship. He said, who from the outside have you invited to speak? I said, well, tonight we invited one of our own faculty members. I think it says a lot about an institution when you can have a lectureship and your opening keynote is from one of your own. Melvin Otey is a professor in our law school, a man of deep faith. He did his undergraduate degree at St. Louis University and his law degree at Howard. He has an MDiv from Ambridge. He has a wife, Janaea, and two boys, Caleb and Christian. A couple weeks ago, I got the privilege to hear Melvin speak at a local church on his love of the text, the holy text, and how it empowers our life It may have been one of the most powerful messages I've heard in a long time. Just a week or so ago, Melvin and I got to spend an hour and a half together just talking about the institution and our future. And now that short conversation, this is a man who has a tender heart for the gospel and for what God can do at this place and what he's doing in the world to bring all men to him. And so I'm privileged tonight to introduce our keynote speaker, Melvin Otey.
Good evening. It certainly is good to see all of you tonight. Appreciate the invitation to come and be with so many good brothers and sisters. Appreciate everyone who's come to participate and support the lectures. And that introduction, I think we can all go home, good introduction like that. I really do appreciate that. Thank you. We've been asked to think about being born of water and the Spirit. So you should open your Bibles. You should turn to John chapter 3, because that is where we find that phrase. And of course, we find the phrase in verse number 5, but I want us to look at the context that is just my way. I want us to think together about how we come to that phrase, the circumstances under which our Lord used it. And then I want us to see if we can understand what he was communicating when he used it. In John chapter 3, in verse number 1, the Bible says, "Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came unto him by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do except God be with him. Jesus answered and said to him, Verily, verily, or truly, truly, I say to you, except one be born anew," some translations would say, born again. Some translations would say, born from above. "Except you are born anew," Jesus says, "you cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can a man enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Verily, verily, or truly, truly, I say to you, except one be born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said to you, you must be born anew. The wind blows where it will, and you hear the voice thereof, but you know not from whence it comes and where it goes. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus answered and said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and you do not understand these things?" In John 3, in verse 1, we're introduced to this man, Nicodemus. The Bible tells us that he is a Pharisee. That is, he's a member of this select sect among the Jews, one of the most influential sects, those who had great prominence in the synagogues. The Bible tells us at the same time that he was a ruler of the Jews. And that suggests, at least, that he was a member of the powerful Sanhedrin Council that ruled over Jewish affairs there in Jerusalem. And so as soon as we meet this man, we come to know and understand that he is a man of some influence. In verse number 10, Jesus would call him a teacher. This man was also a teacher of the Jews, and so he was one who was supposed to be knowledgeable. He was one who was supposed to instruct babes. And he comes to Jesus, the Bible says in verse number 2, by night. It's interesting, if you look at what some people surmise about why he came by night, there are lots of ideas, but I'm just one of those guys who believes in the text, you know, and the text doesn't say exactly why he came by night, but the case is the same. He comes to Jesus and he comes by night. As he addresses the Lord, he addresses him with a degree of respect. A measured degree. He refers to him as rabbi. He refers to him as teacher. Nicodemus is maybe the kind of person that others would have referred to as rabbi. And so maybe by calling Jesus rabbi, he's referring to him as he would one of his colleagues. Yet there is at least a measured degree of respect. Rabbi, he says to Jesus, "We know that you are a teacher come from God." Listen to it. He says, "We know." Friends, I don't want you to miss that, because in the context, it's significant. He doesn't suggest that he's speaking merely for himself. If you remember in John chapter 2, Jesus has cleansed the temple. And when he does that, the Jews, the same people, the Jews confront him and say, "What sign do you show us so that we can know you have the authority to do these kinds of things? Who do you think you are coming to cleanse this holy place?" Jesus, of course, talks to them about his temple, his body, and what was going to happen with that. But later in that chapter, in chapter 2, in verse number 23, the Bible says that he did many signs and many people believed because of the signs that he did. And so the Jews, of whom Nicodemus was part, they asked for a sign. Jesus gave many signs and many people believed because of it. Nicodemus was among those who believed. But when he comes to our Lord, he says, "We know." They asked Jesus for a sign, and he gave them many. And the signs he gave were compelling. And Nicodemus acknowledges that they were. He also acknowledges the ultimate and necessary conclusion that a person had to draw because of what Jesus had done in their midst. "We know you are come from God." I know there was a measured degree of respect, but Nicodemus saw that there was something different about Jesus. He saw that there was something greater about Jesus, that Jesus had some insight. He had some information that he, as a ruler among the Jews, did not have himself. And so he comes to our Lord by night, and he is seeking to get some clarity for himself. In verse number 3, it's interesting. It's almost shocking. It's rather sharp. As best we can tell from the text, no question has been asked yet. Nothing, at least explicitly, has been asked of our Lord. Now, I make some room for the idea that maybe John has truncated this matter some for us. It may be that the initial contact between Jesus and Nicodemus was somewhat more substantial than what has been recorded. But in some kind of short order, when he comes to the Lord, he hasn't even had time to ask his question yet. And the Bible says, Jesus answered and says to him, "Verily, verily," that is, "truly, truly," and some might say, "Amen, amen," "except a person be born anew," "except a person be born again," "except a person be born anew." Listen, in the Greek, it's the same term, sometimes translated "again," sometimes translated "above." Jesus says, "Let's cut to the chase. Let's not waste any time." The Bible tells me that Jesus knew all men. It just wasn't necessary for men to reveal themselves. Jesus knew what was in the heart of men. Maybe he cuts to the chase here because Nicodemus is a part of the group that so often was trying to contest Jesus and would go on and on throughout his ministry standing in opposition to him. Maybe he cuts right to the chase because Nicodemus is a part of that group. But maybe he slices directly into the matter because he knows the heart of the man who stands before him. And he tells him, "Here's the answer. Except a person be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of heaven." He can't perceive it. He can't participate. It seems to be somewhat sharp. It seems to be incisive, certainly. It's interesting, though, that Jesus, having sliced right into the matter, Nicodemus is somewhat befuddled. Didn't you see it? In verse number 4, he asked the same question two different ways. He says, "Wait a minute, can a man be born again when he is old?" And then he asked the same question a different way. Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Now, what does he have on his mind? He's thinking about a physical rebirth. And he knows, as he tries to wrestle with this in his own heart and in his own mind, as he tries to comprehend what the Lord has just laid on him, he knows that it's not possible for a man to be born again. And so he inquires of the Lord, and maybe there's a hint of exasperation in his mind. Maybe there's a degree of consternation in his tone. Are you trying to tell me a man as old as I am, and I don't know how old he was? Are you trying to tell me that a man who has children of his own, and maybe those children have children, has to be born again in order to be right? Now listen, Nicodemus is a man who is looking for the coming of the kingdom. We're introduced to him in this particular chapter. We see him again in John chapter 7, and we see him again in John 19. None of the other gospel accounts mention him by name, but you think about what we see. Here, Jesus speaks to him about the kingdom of God. He comes to the Lord by night. He obviously is interested in some information, and the Lord speaks to him about the kingdom of God. That at least suggests that that was on his heart and on his mind. But in John 19, do you remember what we see? Our Lord has been crucified. Nicodemus is the one who supplied the 75 pounds or so of precious spices that were used to prepare his body. It was Joseph of Arimathea who went and requested the body of our Lord, but Nicodemus helped to prepare the Lord and place him into the tomb where he lay. He was interested in the coming of the kingdom, but he's befuddled by the answer that he has received. It seems to me that the Lord's meaning was altogether lost on him because he was thinking about a spiritual matter through carnal, physical eyes. Jesus says you have to be born again. For all of his learning, for all of his study, for all of his teaching, he couldn't comprehend it. And so the Lord answers him in verse number 5. The Lord clarifies for him what he has formerly missed. And in the doing, he really just makes a parallel statement here. In verse number 5, he tries to elucidate what he has said already in verse number 3. In verse 5, he says, "Except one be born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." Surely you see the parallel. Except a man be born again, except a man be born of water and the Spirit, those two are parallel. He cannot see the kingdom of God. He cannot enter the kingdom of God. Those two are parallel. But Nicodemus is going to struggle a little bit more. Jesus gives him in verse number 6 still some further attempt at clarity. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. He reminds the man who's thinking along a carnal, a physical plane, that man is a dual being. Listen, there is the physical part of man, and there is the spiritual part of man, and the physical part of man is the result of a physical process and a physical birth, and the spiritual part of man is a part of the spiritual process and a spiritual birth. And he says that's the part of man that has to be born again, the spiritual part. He says it's in verse number 7, you ought not to marvel, you ought not to be surprised that I say to you, you need to be born again. Maybe it's the case, you know, Nicodemus, he's of the stock of Israel, so maybe he's thinking that he's in pretty good shape already. I mean, after all, he's a descendant of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and we had that insight in the scriptures that many times the Jews thought they were fine because of that physical lineage. It may be the case that because he was a Pharisee, you know, he sort of looked at his neighbors and he said, you know what, I do a better job of holding fastidiously to the law of Moses than those around me. And I respect these traditions that have been handed down to us, and I keep to those and I teach those. And so maybe he's thinking he's already in good standing. But Jesus seems to think that he should not be surprised that he needs to be born again. Don't marvel, don't be surprised. Then he says in verse number 8, and this is by way of explanation, he says in verse number 8, you know, the wind goes wherever it wants to go. And you can hear the wind, But you can't tell where the wind is coming from, and you can't tell where the wind is going. You know, there are some things that you as a mere mortal, you can't explain, but you can see the effects. And he says, you know, maybe the Spirit is somewhat like that. You can't explain everything about how the Spirit is operating. There may be some things beyond your perception as a mere mortal, but here's the thing. You can see the effect of the Spirit on a man's life. He says, so everyone that is born of the Spirit, you can see the effect of the Spirit on a person's life. In verse number 9, we see that Nicodemus' confusion continues. He says to Jesus, how can these things be? To the extent that he could understand what Jesus was saying, he still couldn't comprehend how it was possible that these things were to occur. And so in verse number 10, Jesus offers this reproof. Jesus answers and says to him, are you a teacher of Israel and you do not understand these things? I want to pause for just a moment. Because there are some times when people set themselves up or are set up by others to be teachers of others. And some of the most basic things that should be understood seem to be lost on them. I'm just saying to you, that happens. And Jesus looks at this man and he's wondering and he wonders aloud, how in the world can you be one who's supposed to edify and educate and equip people to be right spiritually and you don't understand that God requires people to be refreshed and renewed spiritually? How can you be a teacher in Israel and not understand that basic truth? It really is a stinging rebuke. And I think it's the kind of rebuke that for those of us who do a little teaching from time to time, we ought to pay a little attention to that. Because here's a man who probably thought he had it and was gone with it. And Jesus says, you missed it way back yonder. This is the context in which the topic that we're asked to think about has come to us. Born of water and of the Spirit, being born again. What does Jesus mean when he says a person has to be born of water and of the Spirit in order to enter the kingdom? Well, 2,000 years ago, Nicodemus really had some trouble with that. 2,000 years later, people still sometimes have trouble with it. I'd like for you to think with me about this in its context. I've read a lot of things that people have had to say on it, and many times people just ignore the context and start talking about things that sort of we can't verify historically, you know. But what is he saying right here in the context? First, born of the water. Friends, this undoubtedly refers to water baptism. If you will take a look at it in John chapter 1, time and time again, I want you to look at this with me. Time and time again in John chapter 1, we see that John the Immerser was on the loose baptizing people in water. This is before we come to John 3, of course. In John chapter 1 and verse number 6, John answered them saying, I baptize in water. In the midst of you stands one whom ye know not. And he's talking about Jesus there. In John 1 and verse 28, he says, these things were done in Bethany beyond the Jordan where John was doing what? He was baptizing. In what he was baptizing? In the water. Look at verse number 31. And I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. For this cause came I baptizing in water. If you look at verse number 33, I knew him not, but he sent me to baptize in water. And said to me, upon whomsoever you shall see the Spirit descending and abiding upon him, the same is he that baptizes in the Holy Spirit. Do you see a connection? Already you see it. John is baptizing people in the water, and he's looking at Jesus, and he says, listen, God told me the one upon whom I saw the Spirit descending as I'm doing this business of baptizing in water, a close connection between the two already, water and the Spirit. But here's something else that maybe people don't always realize. When Jesus makes this statement that people have to be born of water and the Spirit, Jesus had already begun baptizing people in water himself. In John chapter 3, verse number 26, the Bible says they came to John and said to him, these are some of John's disciples, Rabbi, he that was with you beyond the Jordan, to whom you have borne witness, behold, the same baptizes, and all men come to him. Jesus is already about the business of immersing people in water. Question, why did John baptize people in the water? Question, why did Jesus baptize people in the water? Jesus' message was the same as John's message. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And when people came to him repenting of their sins, he baptized them in the water. Jesus did the self same thing. I tell you this. Have you ever thought about this? Our Lord was more prolific in baptizing even than John the Baptist. Look at John chapter 4 and verse number 1. When therefore the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, and then parenthetically in verse number 2, although Jesus himself baptized not, but his disciples. I think this is really interesting for several reasons. Jesus is doing the same thing that John is doing. He's preaching about the coming of the kingdom of heaven. And as people come to him wanting to prepare themselves to participate in the kingdom of heaven, he's baptizing them in water. I want you to notice something else. The text says that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, and then it hastens to tell us that he wasn't doing the baptizing personally, but his disciples were doing the baptizing in response to the teaching that he was delivering to people. Did you see that? And so when Jesus says a person has to be born of water, what he's speaking about here is the medium. He's talking about the idea that a person is born through the water, that water is part of the process. Now, I don't want you to think that I'm making this up. If you look at Romans chapter 6, Paul speaks about baptism, and he gives us a real good indication here about the connection between water baptism and this idea of being born again. In Romans chapter 6, the Bible says, beginning at verse number 1, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid, we who died to sin, how shall we live any longer therein? Or are you ignorant that we who were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? Listen to this. We were buried, therefore, with him through baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we also might walk in newness of life. Question. Jesus said you have to be born again. You need to have a new life. You need to, and this term is a really good one, you need to be regened, made over again. And he connects this regening, this remaking with the water. Paul later says, when you're baptized into Jesus' death, that old man dies. You go into the grave with Christ, and when you come up out of the water, you walk in newness of life. You've been born again. You've been remade. And so this undoubtedly refers to water baptism, this idea of being born of the Spirit. I say that to you because I look at the immediate context of what is happening just before Jesus says this in John's ministry and in Jesus' ministry. And I look at what happens right after this. Jesus continues to be very prolific in immersing people in the water. And I look at the more remote context of what the apostle says, reflecting on what baptism is. Unless you're born of the water, you can't even see the kingdom of heaven, he says. But then he also says, born of the Spirit. These two are connected together, born of water and the Spirit. This is not two baptisms, or this is not two births, it's one birth. And there are two things that Jesus identifies as being involved in this one rebirth. The water is the medium. The Holy Spirit is the architect of it all. The baptism, listen to it, of John. Jesus will ask the question, from whence did it come? From heaven or from men? Of John. What does that mean? It was the baptism that was the product of John's teaching. John is the one who went out teaching that men and women needed to repent because the kingdom of heaven was at hand. And when they came, their response was to be immersed. And that response was called the baptism of John. Because through his teaching, John was the engineer of that. He was the architect of that. It was the response to his teaching. And I suggest to you in the same way, when Jesus says a person has to be born of the Spirit, he's making reference to the work of the Spirit. He's making reference to the idea that the Holy Spirit of God is the engineer of what takes place. I know it's not lost on you that the Holy Spirit of God is the one who is responsible for the Word of God. I know you know full well the Bible says all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. It is breathed out by God. It comes from God. Listen to it. And it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction or instruction, correction, instruction in righteousness. It's profitable for first and foremost doctrine, teaching. I know it's not lost on you in 2 Peter 1, verses 20 and 21. The Bible says, holy men of God spake as they were moved by his Spirit. And so the Spirit of God gives us the Word of God. Think about this. The response of water baptism to the teaching of the Spirit of God is what brings about the spiritual rebirth that takes place in the water. I don't want you to think that I'm just coming up with this all on my own. I just prefer to listen to inspired people and let them help me understand what the Bible is talking about. Look at 1 Peter, if you don't mind, 1 Peter chapter 1. In 1 Peter chapter 1, we see something about the Word of God and how it enters into this idea of a person being born again or reborn. In 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse number 22 beginning, the apostle says, seeing you have purified your souls in your obedience to the truth and unfeigned love of the brethren, love one another, I love this, with a pure heart fervently, having been, listened to it, begotten again. Does anybody know what the word begot means? Anybody ever heard that before? So-and-so begat, so-and-so begat, so-and-so. He says, you have been begotten again. Now, isn't that what Jesus says? You have to be born again. You have been begotten again, he says, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible. He says there's a seed involved. And what is the seed? Through the Word of God, which lives and abides. It's the Word of God. That's the seed that has to be planted in a man or a woman's heart for them to be born again spiritually. That is to say, for them to be renewed, regened spiritually. The Word of God. And the Holy Spirit is the one who gives us the Word of God. Well, Peter makes the connection for us, and Paul makes a similar connection. And maybe maybe the connection that Paul makes for us is even more explicit. Look at Titus chapter 3. In Titus chapter 3, of course, you know Paul is writing to one of his younger preachers that he's worked with and encourages. He's trying to equip this man. In Titus chapter 3, he makes this comment about the idea of being born again or reborn. Verse number 4 beginning. But when the kindness of God our Savior and his love toward man appeared, not by works done in righteousness, which we did ourselves, but according to his mercy, he saved us. How did he do it? Through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. The washing, the water. This washing is a washing of regeneration, recreation. This washing is a washing of renewing, cleansing what has once been dirty and making it clean in the sight of God. And he attributes all of that to the Holy Spirit of God because it is the product of the teaching given by the Holy Spirit of God. Jesus says that unless a person is born again, anew, unless they experience a birth that is from above, they cannot see, they cannot perceive, they cannot participate in the kingdom of God. Jesus says that unless a person is born of water through water baptism, unless a person is born of the Spirit, as a consequence of the teaching of the Spirit of God, they cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Jesus thought that Nicodemus should have understood this concept about being renewed spiritually. And he rebukes him because he did not understand. I'm suggesting that he didn't understand it, and maybe sometimes people still don't understand it. But the clear import of what Jesus says in John 3 and verse 5 is you cannot be saved unless you go through the water in response to the teaching of the Holy Spirit of God, and you let God make you over again, give you new life in Christ, and usher you into his kingdom. Born of water and the Spirit, it's the only way we're going to make it to heaven. Born of water and the Spirit, it's the only way we can even see, perceive, participate in the kingdom of God. I thank God that he loves us enough to give us an opportunity to be with us in eternity. And I thank Christ that he loves us enough that he laid his life down so that we could have access. I thank God for the work of his Spirit, because if it wasn't for his Spirit, friends, you and I would be lost and we would stay lost. If it wasn't for the Spirit of God giving us the teaching, giving us the insight that we need so that we can respond and be made anew, we would be without hope. It may be the case that there's some among us who say, well, I still need to be born again. I want you to understand clearly what Jesus is talking about. You cannot be saved. You cannot be right without being baptized in the water in response to the teaching of the Holy Spirit of God in the Word of God. I want you to be clear. You cannot be saved from the eternal consequences of your sins unless you go through the water obeying the Spirit of God. You can't see it. You cannot enter without water baptism. Of course, being baptized, that makes you new. Sometimes we get ourselves spiritually dirty again after we've been cleaned up by God. Sometimes we make mistakes. Sometimes we fall short. But we still have the Word of God, and it still tells us what we need to do to be right again. It tells us we need to repent of our sins, and we need to confess to God that we have sinned. We need to ask him to forgive us. The Spirit of God tells us he's faithful and just to forgive us if we do that. Born of water and the Spirit, every one of us needs to make sure that we are, because that's how we can see the kingdom. That's how we can enter into it. If we can help you tonight, we would love to do that. Please let us know if we can and how we can as we stand together and sing this song of invitation.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew my spirit within me. Create in me.
that was an outstanding sermon tonight for Brother Otey? Absolutely. Great way to start. And we're looking forward to more of the same all this week. Tomorrow morning, we start bright and early at 8 a.m. If you can get up that early, you'll be rewarded by hearing our own Cecil May speak in Leicester Chapel on the indwelling of the Spirit. He will be speaking all 3 days in Leicester Chapel at 8 o'clock. The Friends of the Restoration session is tomorrow afternoon beginning at 1:30. And that will conclude with the banquet at 5 p.m. at the University Church Fellowship Hall. And the attendees for that dinner will be paying at the door. Bruce Morton's 3-day session has been canceled this week. However, 3 general session speakers have been added to the program during the 2:30 time slot in HP 108. On Monday, our brother Sam Long will be speaking. On Tuesday, Will Hester, my oldest son, will be speaking on the instrumental music question Revisited. And on Wednesday, Charlie Boddy will be speaking on building blocks and cement for a strong home. The Youth and Family Summit begins tomorrow afternoon at 1 o'clock in HP 135. And Lisa Williams is the speaker for the ladies' class tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. She'll be addressing the conquering spirit. Monday evening congregational singing will be at 6 o'clock tomorrow evening here in the University Church Auditorium. And our keynote tomorrow evening at 7 o'clock will be David Shannon from Mount Juliet, Tennessee, speaking on the subject, Holy Men of God Spoke as They Were Moved by the Holy Spirit. Make sure that beginning tomorrow that you register. There will be a registration table set up in the atrium, and we want you to register, especially our speakers. You have a registration packet that you need to pick up, so we want you to be aware of that and make sure you do that. Those who wish to take the Lord's Supper who did not have an opportunity this morning, well, please go to the seminar room to be served during the singing of the closing song in just a moment. Our closing prayer will be led by Brother Fenter Northern. So please stand as we sing the closing song.
I stand to praise you, but I fall.
Thank you, Brother Otey, for that great sermon. Let us pray, please. Almighty God, our Father in heaven, we're so grateful unto thee for the privilege of being thy children, for coming together in an assembly such as this to begin this week of series of teaching thy word to lift us up in the Holy Spirit of the Lord. Holy Father, we're thankful for this lesson tonight that teaches us so plainly what we must do to be born again, to be Christians. Help us now as we take this into our heart to realize that we who have gone through this process have been raised to walk in newness of life. Help us then to carry it from this building and live it out in our everyday life, that others might see thy word who never read the Bible, but may see it in us. Pardon us of our sins. Bless everyone in this assembly tonight who come here to hear this word. May this be a great lectureship this week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.